Hey everybody, I just want to take a moment to talk about a new thing I'm doing. Over the years, many of you have reached out to me telling me how much you love the podcast, but also wish there were more personalized takeaways and more in-depth interactions with our guests to hear what they think about comedy. This is why I'm now launching my new digital academy, Blueprint for Success. With exclusive interviews and comedy philosophies of stars and industry veterans, personalized versions of the industry standard podcast, commercial-free, and one-on-one coaching time with me. Blueprint for Success will give you the powerful tools that will take you up the elevator beyond the competition and reach the highest possible levels to achieve your dreams. Whether it be stand-up, sketch, improv, acting, writing, producing, directing, hosting, radio podcasting, social media influencing, or even if you want a career behind the scenes as a manager or an agent. Now I'm here to help, personally. We'll go on an express train of comedy and entertainment like nobody else has before. You can find out more about Blueprint for Success and the comedy business on my website at barrykatz.com. Together, we'll take your career where you want it to go.
We never had an exit strategy or a escape plan, or people would say, what were you guys going to do if you didn't make it? You know, after we loaded up the U-Haul truck, we quit our jobs, we moved out to LA, and the truth is we never had a plan. We were so headstrong and so confident that we would make it.
Welcome back to another episode of Industry Standard with me, Barry Katz. I should tell you before I start, I've always stressed to you guys over and over again, the audience, there's very important things about our business. The most important thing is showing up early, okay? That's the biggest thing in the world. I talk about that all the time. Today, I completely screwed up. I emailed my guest today, who I am unbelievably excited about to interview, David Zucker. I email his assistant, 10:30. It's all set. We're going to make it work. Everything's fine. And then, of course, I look at my calendar and it says 1:30. I have a pitch meeting early in the morning. Same time, I realize as I'm driving, oh my God, I have completely screwed up. And I don't have David Zucker's direct email or cell phone, because there's something about just wanting to really bother people. I like to do things in a certain way where I can sometimes work with the people that they pay to actually do the job, to do things and get them the information. And his assistant did a magnificent job. But, you know, frantically emailing the guy as I'm driving down the PCH, swerving back and forth, canceling another meeting to be with him, because I know how important it is, and I know how important it was for him to honor this commitment for me, and I appreciated it so much. And here I am telling the assistant that I'm late. But the assistant, of course, probably can't get in touch with David right away, because so I rush up to the lobby. He's there, and I think he's going to be so angry at me and so mad, and he is the calmest, kindest person in the world, and just really made me feel at ease in my moment of stress. And as Jay Moore once told me, don't spook the thoroughbred. And in this case, I'm not the thoroughbred. David Zucker is the thoroughbred, but he treated me like I was the thoroughbred. He treated me like everything was going to be okay. He treated me in a calm way. And I say this often in this podcast, and I never know what I'm going to say in my cold opens, but I think the thing I want to say is this. One of the most important things that you can have in your life and your business is calm. Nothing ever went wrong when you throw calm at it. And yes, there's things that would have happened negatively if you threw calm at it, but for the most part, that's not the case. It just won't normally happen. As David Zucker brings a rock from my desk that says calm on it, which I have on my desk as a paperweight, ran over and got that for me. So I just feel that way. Now, granted, if there's a fire in your apartment, I don't think calm is going to always work. You probably have to be calm and rush out as fast as you can. If there's a guy with a gun to your head and he's threatening to kill you, yes, calm, but maybe as a backup, maybe not. But for the most part, calm wins. Calm always wins. And type AAA personalities and people who are short and curt and rude and to the point and whatever, it doesn't normally work. And I think back to something that I remember, I believe it was an interview that Leslie Nielsen did one time, a great, great actor who talked about all the movies that he'd been in. And I believe he was asked, which director would you prefer to work with the most of anybody? And he said, David Zucker. And I would imagine a lot of that had to be because he made Leslie Nielsen feel calm. He made Leslie Nielsen feel safe in the choices he was making because he was working in a genre that is not an easy genre to do. And we're going to talk about this later about the kind of genre that David Zucker specializes in, but it's an amazing specialty that's very rarely seen and used, and you can count them on half a hand in the history of filmmaking, where you actually take people who act out parts in a straight way and they become actually 10 times funnier than they would if they didn't. And the fact that Leslie Nielsen, one of the greatest actors of our generation, felt that way about David Zucker, and the way that he was to me this morning when I came into this lobby with all the things that weren't right, all the things that weren't the way that he handles things, and he handled with calm, I can tell you right now that we're going to have an amazing podcast. Because if he had handled things in a way that most people handle things, with a snide comment, a sarcastic bite at me, an attitude like, go fuck yourself, I deserve to be treated better, but he didn't. He felt it inside, and he held it down below, and he showed me the comment. No, I'm kidding. He didn't do that. So my advice to you and the gist of this cold open would be, listen, everybody. If ever you want to send that text after somebody sends you that horrible text, stop yourself. Don't send it. Wait. Wait until you're calm. Think about what you're sending. Send a text that you could send to Mother Teresa, your grandmother, and your mother on her worst day. Same thing. If somebody says something or does something that you feel slighted or whatever, take a step back. Think about it. Be calm and handle things that way. And I can guarantee you in every area of your life, it will improve.
Here we go in 3, 2.
This show will have laughter.
I got everybody pregnant with Barry Katz and semen.
I'm not comfortable with the tone this is taking.
If you're undeniable, you will not be denied.
If you want to be successful in showbiz and you get yourself a Jew white manager like Barry Katz.
Being a manager is just turning no's into yeses.
Creating holy shit moments.
Undeniable.
You fucking firing me up, Katz.
I love this man.
Is there anything else I should know?
You're on.
What?
Out of the air!
Barry Katz.
Back in the house.
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 Let's do this.
Okay, let's talk a business thing for a second.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, because I think this is important for our audience. So you get the money from the investor. What does the investor want for his $670,000? So the movie, let's just say, movie gets made. First $670,000 comes in. The investor gets that. Then what was the deal, do you remember, that you made with this investor for every dollar after that? And how was it split between you, your brother, Jim Abrams, and Landis and Weiss?
Well, I don't remember what the split was exactly or what the deal was, but we... you know, the thing made its money back in the first...
No, I know, but you weren't expecting that.
Well, actually, we were... We always were very headstrong. Again, we always expected whatever we did to be a hit because we kept telling people, this is great. This script is going to be great. This is going to be wonderful. You got to do this. It's going to be a big hit. And we did believe it. So we were never surprised. But
all right. So it's going. He finances you. You shoot the movie. And then you have a movie, but no one's bought it yet. How do you get it distributed?
Well, it was financed by United Artists Theater Circuit. It was
so in other words, distributed. So they already just put it in their theaters. So when it opened, how many theaters did it open in?
I don't know. I mean, now I guess a typical release is like 18,000 theaters or something, or 1,800.
So it's an initial
1,800 theaters, I guess. But they opened it in, I don't know, 600 theaters, whatever.
And so it's an initial run.
And all profit. I mean,
$7.1 million.
And the head of United Artists Theater Circuit was this Egyptian guy named Salah Hassanin, who was the scariest guy in the world. Very intimidating. And we were like, nah. But that night, the next morning, on Saturday morning, he calls us. And he was like the most charming, wonderful guy in the world. And from then on, he loved us. And well, there's more to the story later because we took the Airplane script to him.
Well, obviously, yeah. But he wanted to do Airplane, but I would imagine so did a ton of other people after the conductor.
Actually, he could have had Airplane. He could have had the whole thing, but he said, this Airplane, the script is funny, but I want to do it within Kentucky Fried Movie 2. So Airplane would be like a 20 minute, it would be like Fistful of Yen. So, and we said no. And so, we probably, wandered for another year trying to get Airplane made.
Even after the success of the first movie, no one was buying Airplane.
No, I mean, this is what I've learned in the business, among other things, is that they will only let you do what you've already proven that you can do. So it was quite a jump to get off the, we were the successful operators of a small theater on Pico. But to go to the next level was a big deal to get Kentucky to be the writers and producers of Kentucky Fried Movie. The next level, Airplane, was, well, we had to direct.
What was the budget?
Of Airplane?
Yeah.
$3 million.
Got it. And so how do you get that off the ground?
Well, that we took to every studio in town, and some studios loved the idea. We took it to Mark Rosenberg at Warner, loved the idea, loved us. And then he read the script and he said, no, he didn't like the script. So it's just, it goes back to that one question you asked, how do you write it on the page to, to reflect, what you're spoofing, and it all is in the eye of the beholder. I mean, some people thought it was good, some people didn't. So, but fortunately, there was one guy who believed in this idea from the start, and it was pure. That was pure luck, for us. And it was Michael Eisner at Paramount, who heard about the script at a dinner party, and excused himself from the table in the middle of dinner and called Katzenberg and said, "There's this Airplane script. Have these guys in my office on Monday." And so we got the call, and we were at Paramount on Monday, and I'll never forget that because we were impressed by the carpeting on the floor.
What was impressive?
We were in a real studio, because it was like this rich studio carpet. But we'll never forget the carpet at Paramount.
So there wasn't a lot of places with carpeting back then.
We never noticed. I think Warner's had more of a tight weave, and the Paramount carpeting was more lush.
You didn't even mention the carpet here. Anyway.
Yeah, this would be more on the cheap side. Yeah. This would be more of the Warner Brothers, yeah.
This is the Shaw, Costco.
Yeah, we would not have remarked about this, but yeah.
Awesome. All right, so you get it going. He buys the movie, and now you're off, and you're doing Airplane.
Yeah, we're doing Airplane. They took us through rewrites. And we did many more drafts at Paramount under the auspices of Katzenberg and some of their story people. And you know, we were very frightened of the big bad studio ruining our precious script. And in fact, they improved it. So we were really grateful to Eisner and Katzenberg. I just can't say enough good about them. People always make fun of studio executives or, you know, say how, you know, horrible they are or what Neanderthals they are. But in this case, we were very lucky to have landed at Paramount, which was an all-star team. There was Barry Diller was there, Frank Mancuso, Dawn Steele, Bruckheimer and Simpson were there. So many great people.
Tell me one note that Eisner or Katzenberg gave you that improved Airplane.
Yeah, they gave us notes. Well, here, one of the big things is, you know, we were such purists that we wanted to shoot it on a prop plane because of Zero Hour, 1957 movie, and in black and white. And Eisner said, absolutely not. It will not. You cannot do this on a prop plane. So we went through every level at the studio and everybody said, no, Eisner won't have it. And so finally we had a meeting with the man himself and we said, we are absolutely set about this, Michael. And we explained to him why it would be funnier to do it in black and white on a prop plane. And Eisner listened very politely and we finished our explanation and he said, well, you know, you guys have really done a great job of explaining this. I really hadn't realized, you know, just how passionate you were about these particular points. And you may well be right about it. And you may make this movie, you may actually make this movie in black and white and on a prop plane. And it could be a big hit, but it won't be at this studio. And so there's this big silence. And so Eisner kind of rescued us and he said, but don't give me your decision right away. You guys think it over the weekend. This was on a Friday. And let's meet again on Monday and we'll discuss it. And so we met again Monday. Of course, we totally caved. And he was right. He was absolutely right. So, you know, there's it's just a good lesson on at least what the studio system was then. Now the studios, I don't think they have people as talented as Eisner and Katzenberg running studios these days. Or it's people who make horrible bosses nine, you know, whatever stuff they're coming out with now. It's all sequels, remakes, big stars, whatever.
Tell me the last comedy movie you saw in a theater where you actually left the theater and you're like, much respect.
Oh,
amazing.
Much better than much respect. It was Bad Grandpa.
Bad Grandpa.
It was hilarious. And so I was so grateful to this guy, Johnny Knoxville, for having done this. Because otherwise I would think, well, I'm just, you know, I'm old and I'm bitter. I don't get modern comedy anymore. I mean, you could easily think that because I don't like anything. I don't like any sitcoms. I Larry David, I like. And
so you like Curb Your Enthusiasm. You like Louis.
I like Louis C.K. But everything else, it's impossible for me to watch. But although I acknowledge that they're good.
Tell me a television show that's a comedy that's sort of like on the border, like it's not Louis for you, it's not Curb, but you're like, okay.
It's just everything else that I recognize, it's good. I mean,
nothing that's like on the line.
Modern Family, for instance. It's a good show, but I cannot stand to watch it. And I don't mean to, you know, denigrate it, because it's great. I wish I had thought of that. But it's just, it doesn't make me laugh.
Got it. So
my son is watching Friends right now. He's watching Friends.
How old is he?
He's 15.
Got it.
He watches South Park, which I think is funny. And of course, I worked with Matt and Trey, and they're really funny. But the movies that I've gone to see that I could just count, I can tell you what they are.
Tell me.
They're Bad Grandpa and Bridesmaids.
Okay.
I also remember
Judd Apatow.
Yeah. I mean, But not everything Judd does is something that, you know, I respond to. But, you know, that was good. I thought it was good.
What are the other three?
There were nothing. There weren't anything.
That's it. Bad Grandpa and Bridesmaid.
It was Bad Grandpa and, well, the rest I haven't seen because I don't really go to movies that much.
All right. Tell me a comedy movie that you felt the same way about before you ever made a movie.
Well, the Woody Allen movies, like Play It Again, Sam, and Take the Money and Run, Bananas. We loved those. And I liked, I suppose, you know, Blazing Saddles and Young Frankenstein of the Mel Brooks movies.
So Airplane opens, it kicks ass. Now you guys have money in your pockets. People are calling you left and right. They want to do business with you. Paramount is trying to re-up and do more movies with you. And then you start, I believe, with the idea of the Naked Gun movies. And tell me how it's possible that you have the vision and belief that you're going to take a professional athlete and make him an actor that's going to score in these movies.
Oh, are you talking about the OJ thing?
Yes, I am. Let's just, this is pre-anything happening.
Pre-anything happening.
Because people didn't put athletes in movies.
Yeah, people, that was the thing. I mean, and people put athletes in movies, and they obviously couldn't act. And OJ was in that category, because he was in, I mean, he was in movies, you know, as one role or another. And even Zero Hour had Crazy Legs Hirsch from, you know, running back for UW in that, and he couldn't act. So we just thought that was kind of
so you thought it was funny hiring somebody couldn't act.
Yeah, couldn't act.
But
yeah.
I thought that you...
And so we hired Kareem.
Now, Kareem, respect Kareem wherever you are. I love you. You're a Hall of Famer, not an actor.
Right.
O.J. Simpson, you made into an actor.
Well, yeah, O.J. got better and better. The first Naked Gun I remember was, you know, somewhat of a, you know, I had to squeeze it out of him a little bit, but he was able to do it. But he improved with each movie until he, you know, killed people.
I'm sorry, I'm laughing about that. But, well, this is what I think about at times. Like, I think about Robert Kraft, okay? He meets with Aaron Hernandez, the owner of the Patriots, and he meets with him and he said, listen, did you do this? And Aaron Hernandez says, no, I didn't. Then he gets arrested. And then what happens, I wonder oftentimes, and I don't know why, maybe it's my sick mind, because it's never happened to me, where you have a friend or somebody who's an associate you've been close with is accused of a horrific crime. Is it the psychology of you as a person to just say, okay, I'm never talking to this person again? Or are you, as a person, innocent until proven guilty? And did you talk to him throughout the process until the verdict?
Oh, no, I wasn't that close to him. I mean, I just, the last time I ever saw OJ was at the Naked Gun 33 and a 3 rap party. I sold him my knife collection, and I never saw him again. That was it. No contact. So, but it's like, I remember when I first heard about it, I kind of felt sick when it was days after that when they started to think he was, you know, he could have been implicated.
But you work with him hundreds of days. Could you ever imagine or see any quality in him that could possibly be a person who could ever do that?
No, you never think of that he would actually, you know, stabbed to death two human beings. No, you just...
Because I'm sure you worked with people who you could think could stab people.
Yeah, like Michael Madsen, perfectly capable of stabbing people on Bundy Drive. But, of course, Michael Madsen is a super guy, wonderful guy. He just has this great acting style that makes him look, you know, mean and bloodthirsty.
How do you decide whether you guys direct a movie or somebody else directs a movie? Because some you didn't direct... And some you did, and it seemed odd to me because I would think you always want to direct with your brother.
Right, well...
And Jim was directing with you guys, so
well,
the three of you...
we decided to go our separate ways as far as directing after Ruthless People. And so, you know, we wrote the first Naked Gun together. And but I directed that on my own. Jerry did Ghost on his own and First Night and Rat Race. And Jim did a movie called Big Business with Bette Midler, and then the Hot Shots movies.
But you guys, when somebody didn't direct, the other one produced.
Sometimes. I mean, I didn't have anything to do with Rat Race.
So you didn't.
So we weren't together. No, we kind of split up. Jerry and I kind of ran an office together, which we called Zucker Brothers for a while. But we did all independent projects. I mean, the Naked Guns were pretty much me, and Jerry did Ghost and First Night, and produced My Best Friend's Wedding.
Got it. Talk about BASEketball and your association with Matt and Trey from South Park, and talk about how this isn't fictional.
Right. Well, you know, I met Matt and Trey because a lot of these people come to town, and I mean, you know, there's really talented people, and they stop off at our office, you know, through one thing or another. And I that's how I got to know the Farrelly brothers. And in fact, I started playing BASEketball. Just a friend of mine and I were playing horse, and then we started playing tip horse. We got bored with that, and then we just evolved the rules to BASEketball to make it actually baseball rules, and played that on my driveway. And then other people, and then when we had two other guys come in, we played 2-on-2.
Explain just in the shortest time you can, because I don't want to waste your time. Well, the rules of BASEketball.
You shoot from different areas of the court for a, you know, like from the free throw line is a single, two steps back on a sidewalk is a double, on the slant leading to the street is a triple, and from the street is a home run. And you can bunt from, it's a very short side shot from the sideline. And if you tip in a missed shot with less than one out or less than two outs, you can get a double play. So there, you can erase the base runner. So they're imaginary base runners, and more people started coming into this thing until we had eight teams, among whom were, you know, Richard Lovett and Doc O'Connor.
Richard Lovett, who's the chairman of CAA, probably.
Yeah, he was on it. The Farrelly brothers were in it. Just a whole bunch of people. Not Matt and Trey yet, but they played later. But a lot of people were playing BASEketball on my driveway, and we'd play three major tournaments with these eight teams, and then the top three teams would have a lock on the playoffs, and then everybody else would play a round robin for the wild card spot, and then we'd close off the street, and have this the championship game, and the final year we had the street closed off, and two different local stations covered it, among whom was Keith Oberman, and so it was incredible. It was just, you know, and we played the highlights on video. We had an edit up of the whole season, because we would video every game. Anyway, so we decided we should make a movie about this, for better or for worse, and that became BASEketball. And we pitched it to Universal, and they wanted to do it. And originally we were considering Chris Farley being in it, but Matt and Trey came in, and so we decided to use them. And they also came and they helped write it too.
You alluded to something, so I'll just talk about it. Why do you think certain movies don't work, even though there's hundreds of people working on it, including yourself, and you're every step of the way, and you believe in it, or else you wouldn't spend that many hours on it, and then it goes out there in the world and people just don't come? What do you attribute that to?
I attribute it to the scripts. You know, the script, it's really tricky, and it comes down to plot and character. And if you don't absolutely nail that plot and character, you won't have the people having a kind of a completed, satisfied feeling, you know, when they walk up the aisle. When, you know, Alex Karras once wrote a book, and he was athlete, now obscure, but I mean, he was the Detroit Lions Hall of Famer, and he wrote when the Lions would play the Packers, they would beat them the entire four quarters until they looked up at the scoreboard in the end and see that they lost. And so that is what I would kind of liken Top Secret to. And so it was just the greatest movie ever in terms of jokes, but it was unsatisfying as far as, you know, character and structure and plot. And so poor Val didn't really have a character. That's why it was so difficult to get along with, we think, during the production. Because I think he was just felt that he was kind of floating. And so, I mean, we blamed him for many years, but it wasn't his fault. It was really, you know, the more we learned about, you know, what we did, the more it was the fault of, you know, Top Secret. It was the script. But recently we've recut Top Secret and it's a lot better. It actually has an ending now. It needed a joke at the end. And because we played it at Sketchfest in San Francisco, the film festival, and got a huge reaction. And it's just, but for a few scenes, it was great. It worked great. And the ending could have worked great. And so we fixed it. And so we went to Paramount and we recut it. And I don't think Paramount's going to re-release it. But actually, we're doing the same thing with Airplane now. We're, you know, this week we're recutting the second half of Airplane. Because these movies still play in front of live audiences and they're still funny. So we've played Naked Gun and that's still funny. Airplane and Top Secret. Those are and we're going to show, I think in the fall, we're showing Ruthless People.
Awesome. So tell me about Scary Movie and your association with Keenan Ivory Wayans and how it all came together.
Oh, well, I don't have any association with Keenan, except that we had lunch once and he's a lovely guy. And, you know, he just always complimented me and said that they had, you know, really been influenced by Kentucky Fried Movie. And they did, you know, I'm Gonna Get You, Sucker. And I've always been a fan of their stuff. And they did the first two Scary Movies. And I think the second Scary Movie was troubled because and not as successful. Probably, I don't know the story because I'm not really in contact with those guys, but I think the studio, you know, forced them probably to do, you know, meet deadlines, forced them to do a script a certain way. And I don't know that it was their fault. But in any case, when it came time to do Scary 3, I think that they didn't negotiate with the studio, instead opting to do a movie with Joe Roth at Revolution. And I think that angered the studio. And so they called me. The studio did. And this is, you know, independent of the Wayans. They asked me to do Scary 3. And at the time, I was, you know, basically in director's jail ever since BASEketball. And I had done one movie for the Weinsteins, for Bob Weinstein, which was an Ashton Kutcher movie. I think it's the only Ashton Kutcher movie to flop. And so, but he said, but Weinstein wanted me to direct Scary 3. So I said, sure, you know, where's the script? And so,
why did he give you the shot when you were in director jail and everybody else wasn't giving you the shot?
Actually, you know, Bob Weinstein is a guy who, well, first of all, he didn't blame the failure of the Ashton Kutcher movie on me. He told me you're a better director than your material. And so he never blamed me for it. And he was just always, always nice about that. And he doesn't care about what you've done or your politics or anything else. He's a guy that cares about the bottom line of, you know, can we make a good movie? Not a good movie. Can we make a successful movie? And so he called me. And he didn't care that maybe he even liked basketball. I don't know. But he had confidence that I could do it. And I was, of course, willing to do it because I was I was set to do a Rob Schneider movie, and I was 2 weeks away from getting on a plane to go to New Zealand for that. And I wasn't all that excited about doing that, but that was canceled. So I was available, and Weinstein called, and I was able to get Proft again on the show, and then Weiss to produce, and Craig Mazin to also write. And we had a great team, and so we did two really, really successful movies with Bob.
And talk about getting the shot to do something when things weren't necessarily going well. And a lot of times it's like, it's hard enough to get that shot. But then to get a shot to produce something that's nowhere even near your lane, which is what happened with what I consider to be a really good movie, Phone Booth.
Oh, yeah.
So here you are, you're a comedy guy your whole life. How does anybody give you the keys to the kingdom or get you involved with something that's a drama?
Well, this was, see, after I was had Zucker Brothers with my brother.
Yeah.
Then our Universal deal ended, and I went in with the head of our company, whose name is Gil Netter.
Of course.
And you know Gil.
Yes.
And Gil and I had a company called Zucker Netter, and Gil found Phone Booth and Walk in the Clouds. And we worked on that. We worked on, you know, draft after draft of Phone Booth.
But you're not, but you're, you never written the drama.
Well, but there's so many things.
I know you say that dramas were the things that inspired your comedy.
No, it's just there's certain things about, I mean, I'm a fan of drama. And I think I could direct it if I wanted to. I could direct a drama if I could, you know, get myself to be serious for 10 minutes. But, like, you know, my favorite movies are not comedies, really. But it's like, it's The Godfather 1 and 2. Those are my favorite movies. And so I'm whatever the movie is, it comes down to character and structure and plot. And so I know enough about that to be able to do that. And we had a really good writer, and Joel Schumacher was the director.
Of course.
Yeah.
He directed his first film, I believe. Do you remember what this was? I hope I get this right.
Now, I don't know anything about film history.
Remember the movie DC Cab?
Yeah, I remember. I never saw
all those comedians in it. But so what's it like as a director? Tell our audience, what's the difference between directing a comedy? I know you didn't direct Phone Booth,
right?
But is there some fundamental difference for directing a comedy than there is a drama, or is it all the same to you?
I think directing a drama is much easier, I would think, because you don't have to. It's in comedy, you can't fool anyone. I mean, you can on TV because you have a laugh track, or you have people just in their homes. But in theatrical comedy, you're out there. If it's not funny, it's really embarrassing because you have an audience there, and you can tell that no one's laughing. So it's so technical. It really is. And and the timing and the you know, the camera angles, you just have to use everything. I think it's a lot more complicated. And to direct Spoof is easier than being able to just turn the camera on Adam Sandler or, you know, Robin Williams or Jim Carrey or any of these people who are just, you know, funny. That's what we call a switch flipper, when you can just flip the camera on and Jim Carrey does his stuff. I mean, there's not too much you need to do. But for the style of spoof comedy that we do, everything has to come from really behind the camera. It's all very technical, and it's all serious actors. And, you know, the timing has to be right, and the dialogue has to be right, it just has to be perfect. So it's just harder. Although I'm saying this not having ever directed a drama, but I'm not saying that Coppola's job was easy in The Godfather.
No, but I hear you. All right, final roundup. I'm going to do a little word association. I'm going to mention a name of somebody and just tell me the first thing that comes to mind, anything. Weird Al Yankovic.
Naked Gun. And he's also a dad at the school that my kids go to.
So you found them at the school and cast them?
This was way before kids in school. But he was a friend of a producer, Bob Weiss. So Bob Weiss would say, can you get, do you have any bit for Weird Al to do? And so we cooked up that thing in Naked Gun, which is just a great joke, one of my favorite jokes. And so then we were sure to put him in every movie since then. And he's just such a nice, nice guy. He's just like, there's no edge to Weird Al. I mean, he's amazingly funny, but he's just nice. He's a nice boy. Anyways,
Dennis Hopper.
Oh God, Dennis Hopper. Do you want one word?
You can say anything. You can say a story. We can say.
So
anything.
I directed him in
American Carol.
American Carol, and well, two things. I told him that he had to sit a certain way and with a gun in his hand with his back to the, he played a judge, and he said, why are you making me sit this way? I should be up on the, you know, behind the judge's bench. You know, he was kind of an irascible fuck, and so I said, okay, yeah, do that. And he was right, you know, so he's, sometimes these people are right, you know. So and then he's doing it, but one thing I do insist on is no pauses. And you could ask Michael Madsen. I've had famous battles with Michael Madsen about, you know, do it again, but don't pause between the and the, you know, that, and because of the comic timing has to. So I did a reading for him. This is how I want you to do it, Dennis. Blah, 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 blah. I just did it right there. You know, bad acting.
Game of line said, reading.
Yeah. But he interpreted it as a line reading. And so, and he says, I haven't gotten a line reading since I did, you know, he mentioned some movie 20 years ago. I haven't gotten a line reading from a director. I said, I'm not giving you a line reading, Dennis. I'm just, yeah, forget it. You know, like, you know, what can you do? So I didn't like him very much. And then when we came to say goodbye, he was all smiles and, yeah, great. Nice working with you, David. Everybody, this is Hollywood. This is the movies. Everybody.
Jenny McCarthy.
Jenny McCarthy, wonderful. Just nicest person ever. And, she was just great. What can I say? And then I think I directed her in two movies. There were two things that we did. I can't remember what they were. One was BASEketball.
Priscilla Presley.
Oh, the sweetest person ever. And what a surprise that she's just so sweet. You know, she's just, when you think of what Priscilla Presley must be through, well, she must have an edge and be hip and all this stuff. But she's really like someone that would have lived next door to me in Milwaukee.
Charlie Sheen.
It was like driving a Lamborghini, directing Charlie was such a pleasure. And believe me, I'd want to say something bad about him, but I can't. There is nothing bad except that he smoked on the soundstage. And if I ever did a whole movie with him, I'd say, Charlie, you gotta, you know, use a vapor cigarette or something. But it really made me sick, all that cigarette smoke. But he's so good. He and Leslie Nielsen are the best.
Kelsey Grammer.
Also great guy, and I think I just did American Carol with him. I don't think, and we always wanted to do another movie together, and he's also become a personal friend, so that was one of the few I actually hung out with.
The Farrelly brothers.
Oh, the Farrellys I met way back in 1984 when I knew their writing partner's sister, and she gave me their script. And I kind of eye rolled and said, I'll read it. And it turned out to be Dumb and Dumber. And I thought, this is great. And this was years before. So finally he gets it going. And Pete has never directed. And he's been on the basketball team. And I didn't even realize this is Pete Farrelly on my driveway. He was just this kid who was a funny guy and a funny writer. And I remember he had never been on a movie set before, like us before Kentucky Fried Movie. He just wanted to know what it was like. So he was on the set with us for a week on Last Naked Gun.
And finally, Bette Midler.
Bette Midler, very nice. She was just so talented, and
because you know,
is.
I don't believe you worked with that many people who were a star as a musical artist.
Yeah, but she's also an amazing comedian, actress, and she actually hated herself in Ruthless People. For some reason, she didn't like it, or didn't. It was embarrassed about something. Years later, we met again. There was a day at Disneyland when everybody brought their kids, and she said, "You know, I wanted to tell you this is Ruthless People is the best movie I ever made." So that was nice to hear from her.
Wow.
Yeah.
Tell me your greatest disappointment in show business and how you turned it into something positive.
Well, the first greatest disappointment was Top Secret. When that was released, and the second greatest disappointment was BASEketball. Just shocked, because I thought those movies were so great, and then it just flopped. And how you resolve it, I mean, it's like getting out of prison. You just have to dig your tunnel and just escape somehow. And it's very difficult. It's as hard as starting into the movie business in the first place is overcoming a flop.
Is it a psychological thing where you go out into public and you start taking meetings and you know the elephant in the room is there? And
yeah, that big flop, yeah. I took a lot of meetings, and then tried to get things going, producing. You know, Gil Netter was a big help. Like, Gil would cook up these ideas, and like, he cooked up an idea, we're going to do Smoking the Bandit, a remake with all black people. And so we go into a meeting at Warner Brothers. And, years later, I went to Warner Brothers, and one of the young executives said, I was at that meeting when you pitched us Smoking the Bandits because of what I said. Because halfway through the meeting, because I wanted to produce it. It wasn't something I was passionate about. And Gil is always the salesman. So he said, and David is going to direct it. And so we're there with the Wu-Tang Clan and all their bodyguards, because they were going to be in it. And pretty intimidating. And so I was like a deer in the headlights. And I said, everybody turns to me like, Dave, you're going to direct this? I said, well, I've never directed a Negro movie before. And so, and there was this sucking sound, where everybody said, when did he really say this? And so but everybody cracked up. And so, and people still come up to me and ask me about that and about the horse that we had. A friend of mine from New York, we put a mare in foal so we can name the horse. And we named the horse All Pink and ran the horse at Belmont just so and we told the jockey, don't bother winning the race. Just we named the horse All Pink, and so he said, don't bother winning the race, just run her on the rails. So we get the call, and it's All Pink on the inside. And so, and this was the first of three horses. There was All Pink, then AWL Pink, and Old Pink, and we finally got the call on the third horse. It was like, it took 8 years and about $30,000 to do this joke. Anyways, I forgot what the question was.
That's okay. What's your proudest moment in show business?
My proudest moment had to be, we finished Airplane, and you know, the first preview was a disaster. We, you know, Katzenberg gave us a pep talk and we recut the movie. We played it at UC Davis and it was, it worked. Because the second half was a flop when we showed it for all the executives at Paramount.
What was wrong with the second half?
It was just slow. It was too slow, and it just, and I played the next morning, I played the audience reaction back on tape, and I realized that everything got a laugh. It was just too far apart, and this kind of comedy depends on pace. And so that was like one of the happiest moments when that worked. But it was true that every first preview was a disaster, including all the Naked Guns, including just every movie, the first preview, and especially Scary Movie 3, which was one of the best movies I ever did, was a complete disaster, the first preview. We went back and we reshot for 2 weeks.
Well, one of the things I want to say before I get to the last question, there's a word of advice that I always give every young filmmaker, and I don't know why more people don't do it. And one of the most amazing things you can find, if you're on a Skype with somebody and you want to show them your short film or something like that, you say, go to YouTube and type it in and play it. I'll just wait here while you watch the 3 minutes or whatever. And they're blowing it up on their computer screen to watch your short film. But what they don't realize is that you can see their reaction just right here, looking into the camera, watching the film, and you can see how they react to it. And my advice for every young filmmaker out there, if you're doing a short film, and invite some people over your house who you don't even know. Some you know, but invite people you don't know, or friends of friends of friends. And put a video camera on top of the flat screen TV and press play when you press play for the movie. And then play back the movie and their reaction side by side. And you will know immediately if you have enough laughs per minute to have a movie that's going to sustain and make an extraordinary impact on people. And you knew enough to...
Oh, yeah. We always did that. We recorded the audience reaction in audio. And in later years, we actually had a camera on the audience, so we could see if they even smiled at something. Sometimes we needed to keep that stuff in. You're running out of material.
Awesome. Last question. What advice do you give for the young person somewhere in the world in whatever profession they're in your case, in Wisconsin, growing up there and just doing your own little things and creating your own little theater in the back of a bookstore, going nowhere fast, but something's happening. What advice do you have for a person your side of the business to become the producer, the director, the writer that you become, to get from that point to the highest levels that gotten to?
Sure.
I just want to do a second question for an artist too, because you've cast so many different artists. What does it take to be a great artist, to start from, you know, somebody, because you've given a lot of people shots who never did anything, and some of them performed in your movies and became big stars and others didn't. And what would your advice be for the person in front of the camera as well as behind it?
Quit now, you'll never make it. That's seriously, quit now, you're never going to make it. And the reason why I say this is that, I mean... Here, the other half of this advice is, if you can ignore this advice, you're halfway there. So, I mean, and the reason I say it is I don't want to be responsible for encouraging anyone. It's because it's impossible. And it's like we never had an exit strategy or a escape plan, or people would say, what were you guys going to do if you didn't make it? You know, after we loaded up the U-Haul truck, we quit our jobs, we moved out to L.A., and the truth is we never had a plan. We were so headstrong and so confident that we would make it. And when I hear people say, well, I'll give it a couple of years, and, you know, or for directing, acting, whatever's writing, and see if I make it, I don't think those people are really going to make it, because you have to, you know, you really have to commit to it. If you're around, you just have to hang around and love it. You have to love waiting on tables if that's what it takes for 40 years. Look at, what do you think Carol O'Connor did for, I don't know, 20 years, 30 years until he got All in the Family? He got bit parts. And then late in life, he just hit it big. He just, you know, there was the role that came in that was right for him. And often it's not a measure of if you're good or bad, but if you're just right for it. I mean, John Hamm is brilliant as Don Draper, but I mean, he was maybe 10% lucky that a show like that showed up for him. Other people make their own luck. I think Sylvester Stallone wrote Rocky, and you know, Clint Eastwood, very talented, you know, has really made his own breaks. You have to, now it exists, the possibility for you to make your own video. That it's much easier than it was when I started out, because the, you know, the stuff was really expensive. Now you can do stuff, as you said, on your cell phone. But you have to, I think, more than anything, it's persistence. And I wouldn't advise anybody to keep on trying, just because it's so impossible. But you have to love doing it. And you just have to be headstrong, I think, and not accept no for an answer. But my advice still is quit. You'll never make it. That's because I don't want to be responsible for encouraging anyone. Is that clear, Barry?
David Zucker, you are crystal clear. This has been amazing. And believe it or not, this podcast will encourage many, many people to get into this business, but also...
But not because of me. I didn't...
No.
Give an assumed name.
They'll blame it on me.
All right. Okay.
Good. They'll blame it on me.
All right.
No, it was wonderful. I'm so, so, so grateful to you. Thank you so much.
This was fun, Barry. Thank you.
Hey, everybody. Thanks for listening to the podcast. I want to talk to you about an amazing documentary that I worked on a few years back called I Killed JFK, which was unlike anything I ever did in my life. It's centered on a man who'd been in prison for 30 years, who's the only person in history to have admitted to killing Kennedy, and his story is unbelievable. He started as a runner for the mob. He was hired to drive two hitmen from that city around Dallas, and he ended up being the guy who calibrated their weapons. And he was there that day with one of his own and took the fatal shot that killed John F. Kennedy on the grassy knoll. His story, the footage, the interviews, never been seen before. You can't find them anywhere else except on this documentary. So go to BarryKatz.com to the merch page and buy the documentary with the rare interviews of the five greatest historical experts in the world. So just go to BarryKatz.com, the merch page, pick up the documentary and interviews, and I guarantee it will reverse the way you feel about what happened that day in 1963 and change your opinion of the government and how it works and alter the way you think about things forever.
Lastly, I want to talk to you about something really impactful, and it involves something really close to my heart: self-education. You see, throughout my life, I realized that every success I've ever achieved in my career has come from the education I received from my experiences in the business. And I truly believe that we all have the knowledge inside of us that others would kill for. And by sharing that, we can open up an entirely new world of possibilities for ourselves. That's why I'm so excited to tell you that I partnered up with my friend Tony Robbins, who's been number one in this field for 40 years. Along with his team of experts, Dean Graziosi and Russell Brunson, they'll show you how to take that valuable knowledge in your mind and turn it into an incredibly profitable mastermind, workshop, or event, just like they have and continue to do in their careers. And they're launching a new training program that's literally changing people's lives by helping people like you be a part of this $129 billion a year business. So it's an incredible opportunity for someone like yourself to build your own business, share your knowledge, and help and serve people in a huge way with the guidance of Tony Robbins. the best in the business. He's actually going to teach people like you how to make big money and build a successful business. So if you're ready to take your life to the next level, they're doing a free live training session. BarryKBB.com. That's BarryKBB.com. Look, I've done over 440 free podcast episodes of Industry Standard, and because of your incredible response, it's reinforced my belief that we're morally obligated to share and pass on our knowledge with the world and help other people in those ways. I truly believe this, and I really love this groundbreaking training program and how it can turn your knowledge into an extraordinary amount of money. So just go to BarryKBB.com, that's BarryKBB.com, to this free training session with the best in the business, Tony Robbins. I guarantee you it will change your life forever. As always, this has been Industry Standard with me, Barry Katz. And if you like the show, tell all your friends. And if you don't like the show, tell all your friends.
You get all the money, drive that fancy car. All the people love you, 'cause you're going far. Life is for the dreamers, they have all to gain. It's never quite over till it all feels the same. You pick your own poison, dig your own grave. Down in the valley, a fortune.
Thank you for listening to Industry Standard with Barry Katz. If you'd like more info on our schedule of new episodes or how to reach Barry through Twitter, Facebook, or email, go to BarryKatz.com. Before you leave, please take a moment to subscribe to our podcast, leave a comment, and rate it, even if you think it blows. Thank you for your support, and have a great day.